Diversity Beyond Lip Service, A Coaching Guide for Challenging Bias. Written by Lawana Harris. Narrated by Anna Crowe. Foreword. I first met Lawana after I reached out to meet her. I contacted her because I saw what she did, and I was impressed. I wanted to hear a bit more about her coaching and about her experience as a diversity and inclusion expert. We met very soon afterward while I was speaking at an event, and Lawana happened to be the moderator assigned to introduce me and to facilitate questions after my session. Within a very short time of meeting her, I knew that I had a lot to learn from Lawana. When she asked me to write the foreword for her book, Diversity Beyond Lip Service, at first I was humbled. Then I was nervous. But as Lawana might coach, I'll tell my truth. Part of the goal of a foreword is to tell you what you're likely to get out of reading the book. I'm not going to do that. I won't tell you what you're liable to get out of this. In some ways, that would fly in the face of everything this book is about. Instead, I'll tell you what I got out of it. Because a guide that is focused on how to be authentic and be a better coach, leader, and in many ways a better individual deserves no less than some genuine reflection and truth-telling. What I got out of Diversity Beyond Lip Service was a set of resources. There are relevant models that will help me as I continue to reflect on my personal journey and how I show up in the world as a father of two interracial sons. One, already a man, a sophomore at Duke, and the other, a precocious 8-year-old. Lawana's words about how we choose to embrace, or hide from, our role in pursuing diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging will undoubtedly resonate with me for a long time. I also got a good helping of anecdotes and stories, some that spoke to me as if I could have been the person writing the words, others that mirror experiences I've had during my time in business, and a few that were new and unique. These anecdotes are real, genuine, and heartfelt, and they add a humanity that gives the book warmth and approachability. I don't agree with everything Lawana wrote, and in many ways, I think that's exactly how she'd want it. Lawana provides her point of view, an educated, personal, and experienced point of view, but she doesn't try to convince the reader. Rather, she takes us on a journey of discovery and reflection and allows us to make up our own mind. She introduces us to conflict and pushes us to take a side. She is bold in her statements and powerful in her confidence, and through her prose, she encourages us to be the same. I can think of no better way to honor the truth of her writing than to sometimes vociferously disagree, sometimes intently concur, and other times simply read, learn, and reflect. To see the world through eyes that are not my own, and borrow her perspective on business, coaching, inclusion, and, more broadly, life. Diversity Beyond Lip Service defies being just one thing, and instead is a guide, a resource, a set of tools, and a journal of the experience of a leader in coaching and corporate leadership. That's my truth. Now go find yours. Khalil Smith, Head of Diversity and Inclusion Practice, Neuroleadership Institute. Preface. As a coach specializing in DEIB, diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging, with decades of experience in corporate organizations, I understand the pervasive and limiting effects of less than optimal diversity and inclusion practices, what I call D&I lip service. I know firsthand how the superficial expression of support for a diverse and inclusive culture, without any corresponding action or sincere intent to affect meaningful change, can hinder companies' talent acquisition, retention, and, perhaps above all, bottom lines. You can be sure that I've seen it all. I've encouraged executives to set the standard for diversity practices and watched them reap the corresponding benefits. I've talked teams through tough conversations that helped them turn their ships toward better D&I policies and processes and corresponding boosts in revenue. And I've looked on as leaders refused to acknowledge their biases and systematically dismantled their own organizations as a result, businesses that could have thrived with a broader approach and input from a diversity of voices. I've included voices of diversity throughout the book to help show the tremendous value that diverse perspectives bring to business and society as a whole. I know that D&I efforts make a difference. My impetus for addressing the importance of inclusion and how to create it in the workplace also comes from a myriad of personal experiences, some good and some less so. On the positive side, I still have vivid memories of my first formal diversity and inclusion training almost 20 years ago with the Center for Creative Leadership and the Greensboro Chamber of Commerce. At that time, I was introduced to Other Voices and Leadership Greensboro, two leadership development programs that helped fuel my passion for social justice and shaped the diversity and inclusion-focused professional I am today. Other Voices is a 9-month leadership development and community building program that seeks to examine the many forms diversity takes and to understand the roots and impact of prejudice and oppression. During an eye-opening 9 months, I gained a more holistic understanding of how power, privilege, bias, and prejudice work, and simultaneously engaged in the process of transforming my own culturally absorbed biases. The Leadership Greensboro program is focused on empowering a diverse group of people in Greensboro, North Carolina, to become responsible leaders in business, education, community, and civic organizations, government, and neighborhood action. During these programs, I embraced the leadership and community building model and, along with the other participants, developed pragmatic skills for working with diverse groups for collective action. On the negative side, as an African-American woman living in the South and working in the corporate world, I have experienced the ugliness of discrimination and prejudice firsthand, a reality that is all too common for many who are considered different by virtue of their race, gender, ethnicity, religious affiliation, sexual orientation, disability, age, or socioeconomic status. Suffice it to say that I do not want anyone else to experience the kind of debilitating and disempowering treatment that I have endured inside and outside of the workplace. When I reflect on times throughout history that have been plagued by overt and systemic racism, prejudice, and privilege, I remember the saying, "If you want to know what you would have done back then, take a look at what you're doing right now." I hope that as an African American back then, I would have sat on the buses and marched in the streets during the civil rights movement, or even run away to secure my freedom during slavery. But the reality is that I am alive right now, and there is still important work to do for the advancement of justice and equality for all. To make a difference, all I can do is focus on changing the present. This book is my contribution to progress. And while I'd like to say that my work is solely altruistic, my desire to see momentous progress made in diversity, equity, and inclusion in my lifetime is also fueled by my grandson, whom I love dearly, and would like to protect from all forms of senseless injustice. I aim to help reshape the world so that he and others like him have the same opportunity to use their gifts and abilities to succeed as those who are not perceived as different have long enjoyed. I don't have all the answers, but I will be part of the solution by offering what I've learned about creating inclusion in both the for-profit and nonprofit sectors, with the hope that change will arrive more easily and swiftly for the next generation. The case has long been made for D&I. Our heads are convinced. What we need to do now is work on our hearts to get them in the right, welcoming place, and then use our hands to start creating change. My heart and hands approach is based on provoking meaningful and often uncomfortable self-reflection and brutally honest conversations that lead to courageous action. It is the hard, awkward, and necessary work that needs to be done toward establishing environments in which every individual is committed to being an agent of change within their sphere of influence. It is how we move beyond D&I lip service. Introduction. Diversity and inclusion starts from within. We've been talking about diversity and inclusion for decades. Why aren't we further along? What's really going on? This book is written for the power construct within your organization. Let's face it, mostly white men. As a woman of color, I don't know what it feels like to be at the top of the power structure and look to the left and right and see only people who look like me. I also don't know what it feels like to be a member of the majority who is bombarded with messages, perhaps for the first time in a decades-long career, stating that my utopia is really an oasis that is no longer good for business. However, I want to understand your experience without condemning and judging. I believe it's important to have compassion and empathy for all people involved in diversity and inclusion. And on a more pragmatic level, you are the people who hold the power and the purse strings. If you aren't engaged on a deeper level, we will not see results. I believe that as a society, we have to start where we are. And so, together, let us tackle some of the tough questions that have been avoided in the mainstream narrative, such as, how do we recognize that for some members of the majority, replacing their colleagues with women, people of color, and other underrepresented groups makes them uncomfortable? Let us acknowledge and move forward from the truth that this discomfort fuels an unspoken fear that advancing D&I means you may lose some of your power. Said differently, let us begin from a place of understanding that to those who are accustomed to privilege, equality can feel like oppression. But this is not about my letting anyone off the hook. I firmly believe that members of the majority must move beyond passive support on the fringe to proactively using their privilege to benefit everyone. I just know that we won't get there without a healthy dose of empathy and understanding about what it will take for you, the people in power, to feel good about sharing it. Coaching plus D&I equals changed behavior. Collectively, we can assist with this process by creating a judgment-free environment where majority group leaders are encouraged to explore their role in the power construct. Removing judgment and blame helps establish a foundation we can build upon in order to reframe the role of privilege as a platform to share power, and to ensure that all people are valued and respected and that all voices are heard. We can choose to completely turn privilege on its head by transforming what has historically served as a barrier into an enabler of inclusivity. But it will require a fundamental shift in how we approach D&I. Traditional efforts have been oriented from the outside in. We've spent decades telling people what they should think, say, and do relative to inclusivity. I'm proposing an inside-out coaching approach that encourages individuals to go deep within, to own where they are, embrace radical truth, and do the self-work needed to progress along their diversity and inclusion journey. It is from this precipice that I introduce a new inclusion model and a coaching platform. Inclusion coaching. Based on the most up-to-date research and best practices for creating sustainable and meaningful behavioral change. I also provide an action-oriented process, commit, with simple techniques to shift mindsets and encourage more inclusive behaviors. C. Commit to courageous action. O. Open your eyes and ears. M. Move beyond lip service. M. Make room for controversy and conflict. I. Invite new perspectives. T. Tell the truth, even when it hurts. By introducing a new approach at the intersection of coaching and D&I, I am offering your organization a viable solution for the how of everyday inclusion. Using the tenets and principles of professional coaching, we can get beneath the superficial layers of engagement by shifting the focus away from telling and persuading toward asking the right questions and listening. We can create a space for self-reflection at the level of a person's core values, beliefs, and motivators to find what they need in order to embrace inclusion versus being pushed to simply comply. Because honestly, the latter will only take you to the point of lip service. It's time to move beyond. In this book, In the first chapter of this book, I outline the problem with most D&I initiatives and why so many never go beyond lip service. For example, working diligently to hire diverse employees but not being able to retain them past 1 year. The second chapter is about the language of diversity. By naming the concepts and the ways in which different groups are marginalized, we begin to create more awareness of the workplace practices that unwittingly foster bias, privilege, and discrimination, so that we can more fully explore why we hold on to them. Chapter 3 goes deep into the problem and power of privilege, a critical concept in moving beyond diversity and inclusion lip service. I explore why D&I is hard for the people in power and how we can work empathetically with them to dismantle their resistance and coach them in becoming champions for a more inclusive environment. In Chapter 4, I explain why coaching is the most effective model for behavior change. Short explanation. It encourages people to ask important questions of themselves and play a vital part in their own understanding of D&I and its value. I also explain how the commit coaching model can support individuals in moving beyond D&I lip service with clear guidelines for building a mindset and environment where inclusion can thrive. While the 6 steps sound, and are, simple, they are not necessarily easy. That is why I devote each of the next 6 chapters to exploring one step of the commit process. Then, just as I coach others on facing their truths, I tell my own in Chapter 11 as a model for owning your own stories. Because creating inclusive cultures requires that everyone be on board, throughout the book, I will show how you can do your part to ensure that all voices are heard and valued in your organization's conversation, regardless of where you fall in the power structure. Former clients, contributors, and colleagues have graciously lent their voices and insights to the discussion, although names and companies have been changed for those who prefer to remain anonymous. The application tools throughout the book will also help you take steps toward increasing inclusion at your organization and in your life. You can visit LawanaHarris.com for additional information and resources. A path forward together. My life experiences as an African-American woman compel me to do all that I can to advance diversity and inclusion in the workplace, especially as I face the harsh reality that I likely have more years behind me than ahead of me. With almost 3 decades of civic activism and 2 decades of corporate experience with large multinational organizations, I've experienced the good, the bad, and the ugly. It's time to pay it forward by sharing the triumphs, failures, and lessons learned to help others coming along in the next generation of leaders. And so, instead of beginning to plan for a graceful exit, I'd rather shake things up a bit and leverage my experience as a certified diversity executive, an International Coach Federation certified coach, and a global leadership development professional to offer solutions to improve your overall effectiveness as an individual, provide support to your internal diversity and inclusion function, and share tangible means to reform the exclusionary behaviors and various negative isms felt by many within your organization. We are all at different places along our journeys, some further along than others. We need to put our own biases aside and give the people making the decisions about D&I the space to understand their truths when it comes to the topic, their privilege, and how they feel about all of these factors without telling them how they should feel. From that point of self-actualization, vulnerability, and humility, we can build a path forward together. It's time to face the unspoken truths and deal with whatever shows up. Chapter 1. We hired some minorities, some women, and people with disabilities. Isn't that enough? Increasing diversity without increasing inclusion is a recipe for failure. When Vanessa Robbins was hired by the Atlanta Office of Regional Corporation SETCO, she was excited that her new Assistant Director of Brand Development position not only was a good professional opportunity, but also seemed like the right next step in her marketing career. Ambitious and a hard worker, Vanessa had high hopes for where her professional pathway might lead, partly because in her previous position with a smaller company, she was repeatedly recognized for her outstanding creativity and ability to grasp any problem quickly. It was nice to feel valued by her employer, but it wasn't such a big deal, given that she'd graduated from an Ivy League university and, not coincidentally, both of her parents were physicians. She wasn't blind to the fact that she possessed the right credentials for success in corporate America, in addition to her demonstrated abilities, which had also been well acknowledged during her college years. For their part, the Human Resources Department and Senior Executive Leadership Team at SETCO, who interviewed and ultimately hired Vanessa, an African-American woman, were pleased to move their firm's diversity quotient forward. The pressure they'd been facing from their board of directors was getting intense, and hiring Vanessa meant they could demonstrate progress in an area that they'd long neglected and, truth be told, simply was not a priority. It wasn't as if they'd never read all those studies about diversity and inclusion helping companies gain a competitive edge. They just hoped the push toward a diverse workforce was one of those organizational change fads that would take care of itself without any dedicated resources or attention. They liked the fact that everyone knew what to expect at SETCO. Their organizational sentiment toward D&I could be summed up in a few statements. Things were stable, with the company pecking order well established and religiously followed. Besides, it's hard to even talk to people who aren't like you. They are just on a different page. The whole diversity thing was time-consuming and not worth the extra effort, as far as they were concerned. But they had to do something. And now they had. Hiring Vanessa was the first big step toward a more diverse organization, and they hoped it would work. She was sufficient leadership-level diversity, so the board could return to discussing the operational issues that senior leadership felt far more comfortable addressing. Reflexive marginalization, maintaining the status quo. In her first 3 months at her new company, Vanessa noticed a pattern that bothered her and even caused her to lose sleep a few nights. More than once, she tried to rationalize away the stonewalling she felt whenever she offered her opinions or ideas, telling herself that perhaps she was mistaken. Was she still too new for people to know her name or listen to her suggestions? Whatever the reason, it wasn't what she expected or was used to experiencing. In her last job, there had been a widely diverse workforce and an inclusive corporate culture. The senior leadership team was made up of a diverse demographic of executives that mirrored their employees and customer base. No one felt like an outsider or like they were marginalized because of their ethnicity, race, gender, or sexual identity. Simply put, discrimination hadn't been tolerated in any form, overtly or covertly. If it did occur, it was quickly addressed. But SETCO was different in this regard, and Vanessa was taken aback by that difference. During the extensive interview process, she'd been praised for her accomplishments and background, and for her thoughtful, nuanced answers to the complex questions posed to her. The HR person even told her that several people at the firm saw her as the most qualified and promising candidate they had interviewed in a long time. "They brought me on to contribute at a high level," she reminded herself, thinking back on what was said during her onboarding meeting. "So that's exactly what I am going to do." Focusing on a solution, she came up with a plan. She would do observational research in order to figure out what was going on. At the next 3-team meetings, she carefully studied the group's dynamics. Carl directed the meetings, and Mike and John were usually the ones offering input, while the other woman on the team, who happened to be white, contributed only rarely. When she did say something, Carl would thank her and immediately turn to either Mike or John for their opinion. "So, Mike," he'd say, "what do you think of Rita's observation?" And Mike would reiterate what Rita had said and then talk around it, until it became so buried under his verbiage that her input was long forgotten. "Oh," thought Vanessa, "it's a gender thing." She decided to talk to Rita about the behavior she'd observed. But when Vanessa found a private moment to do that, Rita seemed resigned. "Yeah, they're kind of old school here," she admitted. "But I hardly notice it anymore." "You'll get used to it, too. They expect deference from women. But what else is new? Hey, it's a job, she added with a shrug. It pays well, and I'm a single mother, so I can't afford to rock any boats. My kids and my mother depend on me. My dad died of a heart attack a year ago, and my mom's living with us now. Vanessa expressed concern, saying she could understand Rita's position. But as she walked away, Vanessa thought about the fact that this really wasn't what she had signed up for at Setco, and she felt it, physically, as if she were now buried up to her neck in cement. Later that day, after recovering a bit, she decided to push back. There had to be a way to break through, not only for herself, but also for the betterment of her team and the organization as a whole. Steeling herself at the next team meeting a few weeks later, Vanessa jotted down a few notes while Carl talked, preparing her response to what he was asking the team to brainstorm about. When he paused and looked at Mike and then John, she saw her chance. "What about," Vanessa began, and she laid out a 3-point plan for a marketing campaign designed to launch Setco's new high-value product, which was what Carl had wanted the marketing team to address. Everyone around the conference table turned to look at Vanessa in apparent disbelief. The facial expressions of the men transformed from uncomfortable to sullen, as if they couldn't quite figure out how to process.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.